The other, another of the variation of these would be bahupleda kandukrimi, where the patient would have more of the discharge and itching or even the risk of krimi. This is very typically seen in case of pemphigus. Now, pemphigus, you have mainly two varieties. Pemphigus vulgaris, which is an autoimmune disorder, which has a totally different prognosis, and a pemphigus of a secondary region produced due to upon the drugs. Then there is another pemphigoid lesion. These three are always confusing ones. The issue is a pemphigus produced due to an external agent, either it could be the drug or at times it could be the food also. It is common, like when a patient is administered a specific drug, within 3 or 4 days the patient tend to develop these bullous lesions. It's not rashes, it's the bullous lesions presented, and characteristically this pemphigus induced due to the drugs would not involve the mucosa surface. It's always in the keratinized area. Maximum it may come to the keratomucous junction at the lip, but not beyond that. Whereas a typical pemphigus vulgaris has a higher chance of involvement of the oral mucosa, so that's one of the important issue. Otherwise it may look similar, a bullous lesion occurring rapidly, and it may be even self-limiting disorder. Whereas a pemphigus vulgaris, the whole prognosis is poor. Comparatively, the distribution of these drug-induced pemphigus also is limited to certain area of the body. It's not throughout the body. Whereas a typical pemphigus vulgaris can spread throughout the body and produce very ferocious presentation, which will come to that part when we may discuss about the Agni Rohini later. So there is that difference has to be kept in mind. So that kind of a relatively minor variety of the pemphigus, there is no specific word in the textbook like a minor pemphigus, I use that word. A minor variety of the pemphigus, which is often produced with the drugs, and again, commonest drug which induces this kind of a complication is penicillin. It's commonest. When I say this, it's not only penicillin, it could be many other drugs, but one of the common conditions is penicillin, and these can be comparatively easy to be managed. The only important is to differentiate it from the pemphigus. Pemphigus has a very serious prognosis, whereas pemphigus due to the drug-induced conditions has a relatively easy to be treated. The outcome is comparatively easy, and many times even without treatment at times it may heal. But and the usual choice of the treatment would be Laghusutra Karoti Sarya Adhyasava and Keshava Ukuli is the usual choice of the treatment which I described, and the healing result would be quite easy. But the critical point is to differentiate it from the other cause and identify the real cause. If you know that exact cause, I think the treatment is very simple. It's not as termed as allergy, it's considered as a hypersensitive reaction, though the phenomena is very much similar. Again, I'll not go into the theory issues of that differentiation as part, the next part. Now, the another variation of the Kapraja variety of the Kusta is a Sattagati Samuthana Bedini, where the lesions would not result in a complete disruption of the surface. It's limited to the deeper area of the skin. Now, that word of Sushruta is very important. Sattagati. Sattagati is a there would be tracks of the lesions, but the tracks of the lesion are covered. And occasionally they may rupture, the tracks may rupture. That's the typical of the subcutaneous mycosis, fungal infections in the subcutaneous area. Compared to rare condition, this is not a very common condition, rare condition. But you may have a few of patients presenting with this feature, a variant of the mycetoma. A mycetoma is a superficial fungal infection where you will have multiple tracts opening and then the discharges will occur. Whereas in a subcutaneous mycosis, it is a similar fungal lesions, but they do not rupture easily. The lesions will be in the subcutaneous area, patient will have some vague pain, not very severe pain, often dull pain, and the skin looks rough, irregular like at the area. And rarely, occasionally it may rupture and produce some ulcers. Ulcers could be quite prolonged, like unlike that of mycetoma where you have a small opening, multiple tracts, it may tend to result in a wider ulcer till that whole lesion is opened up. And the condition tends to be very chronic. Prognosis also is poor, the outcome is not definite. And usually again, one or other day the patient would come to ayurvedic treatment and so on, because you do not have a satisfactory treatment anywhere. And my preference would be Keshava Ukuli, same as the mycetoma, because from my point of view it is a Kapraja variety. The only thing is the prognosis is unpredictable. Some of the patients show some satisfactory response, some may not. So it's very difficult to predict exactly what would be the outcome. Right. Next. Then another typical feature of a Kapuja-Kusta is Parimandala, the circumscribed nation. That's a very perfect word which is used in the contemporary terminology as the ring word, Parimandala, ring word, Dictinia corpus. That's a very similar issue, where the nations are circumscribed and characteristically you will have the nations which are expanding towards the periphery, and there is always a central zone of clearance. In the central area there will be no nations left over, and I think that's again very common condition. Patients tend to have these kind of symptoms quite frequently, and a well publicized disease, like almost if you go to any public toilet you will have the advertisements of that lotion, like certain lotions. Yeah? Yeah. Okay, all right. So because that's the point where the people will be aware of the lesion. As long as it is covered, they may not feel the itching. But once it is exposed and handled, they start itching that. And then the naturally, that's the area where the patient persons will remember that they have a lesion. That's why the advertisement, location of the advertisement is strategical locations. So that's the other part. Now anyway, again a common condition. Important is those conditions also you will have rule out the systemic pathologies. Many times it could be the underlying systemic pathology which are the causes. Next is the unhygienic factors. So hygienic conditions also are the other critical issues. And the choice of the treatment would be again same Dandakarathana, Khatiraya, Stairless, Lagusur Shekharavati, Karpura Malahara, I don't, again same issues as I said, like maintenance of the hygiene with the Malahara is one of the critical issues. If we are sure about that, it could be one of the drugs which could be used. Cephalopathy is the other drug. Of course, lots of patent drugs are available in the market with the specific target of these ringworm treatment. Like most of those drugs would have a keratolytic content like salicylic acid, and they may produce a relief temporarily, but in the long run they are the reason for the lichen infection. So better not to use so called keratolytic substances. I am not suggesting any specific name as it, but in the market it's very popular, and very often it's a branded drugs like targeted for ringworm. You have salicylic acid its content. Salicylic acid is a primarily keratolytic substance and which could be used in hyperkeratotic lesion, but not in the lesions with the keratin tissue breakdown. So better I would not, if, and many times the patients will be using those, I would advise them not to use that, because temporarily the patient may have the relief, but in long term it results in the lichenification. The whole keratin tissue becomes thickened, hardened, and then it will be quite difficult to manage. So that's the point, right? Next one. Now the other feature is the Parushani Arunavrata. That's exactly the point, like a hyperkeratosis. Hyperkeratosis is another very troublesome condition. It could be due to the same issue, like a keratolytic substance used regularly can be a cause for the hyperkeratosis, or other causes are the friction over the area. It could be a seborrheic. Seborrheic is an inflammation of the sweat glands. A psoriasis also can present as a hyperkeratosis. And there could be plenty of other causes. So differentiation of that would be the real causes of the hyperkeratosis itself is one of the troublesome conditions. Many times the causes are the more critical issue than really the treatment. Keratolytic ointments have suggested as either a treatment, or it could be many times could be the cause of that. So it's a very difficult issue. If there is a feeling like you can help in keratolysis, I would not use any of those so-called keratolytic ointments. Instead, a simple aspirin tablet crushed in coconut oil applied over the area can be good in making that keratosis lesions softer. It should not be continued for long duration, maximum 1 week. Once the lesion has become softer, then we treat with Aarogyavardhini Sariyathyasava, or in children, I would prefer Aravindasava as a choice of the treatment. And with that you can have a significant result. But the next important part is the identification of the causes of the hyperkeratosis. I think I will come to that issue again later about the hyperkeratosis. Again we will have some more detailed discussion about that maybe later part. Now a hyperkeratosis also can have a variation in the presentation. See, the first hyperkeratosis which I have suggested is where the skin has become thickened at a smaller area and the location is very clearly seen. Whereas a similar issue presented with the Bahiranta Shava, where the color is somewhat shava, bluish in color, and it tends to spread throughout the body, wider spread. That's the typical lesion in case of the variant of the hyperkeratosis where the metabolic causes are the real causes. Therefore, these are metabolic causes. Again, the causes are very difficult to identify. Many times it's considered as vitamin deficiency. Many times it could be due to the abnormal synthesis of the keratin itself. And that's the Figel disease, is a, where there is a metabolic pathology, a complex issue. Now, whatever the efforts you make to make the diagnosis, you make the name of the name, give the name of Figel's disease, next, there is nothing else to be done. So, not much to be done as such. So, see, such patients usually they get adjusted to that. They will have that thick skin, rough, and rarely eating, moderate eating, not much of the severe eating. And usually they are resistant to medical treatment. And the my preference would be the same local applications. Usually, I would not prefer more than any these serious issues. Occasionally, I may suggest the patient to use simple tilakaila regularly, and which can help in lesions as well. A localized single lesion with the hyperkeratosis could be angiokeratoma, a single lesion. When it is multiple throughout in a Figel disease, virtually there is no medical treatment. Whereas a hyperkeratosis occurring due to the angiokeratoma, like it's usually congenital pathology, where there would be a blood vessel and then around that there will be keratin tissue, which is often confused with the wart. Many times it's confused with the wart. Unlike that of the wart, which is very hard and rough, angiokeratosis would be somewhat smoother and it will have a reddish or a bluish color suggestive of the vascularity. And in angiokeratosis, the simple treatment of excision is a better choice of the treatment than any of the local treatment. The local treatment would never dissolve the condition, and any local treatment can produce a disruption and next complication of the sepsis. So better to have a total surgical excision than the other way. Next one. Now, the other variation of the Kabje variety where you will have these lesions are Nirapita Tanda Avabhasani Ashwati Samutranani Kandu Kledakrimi, where you will have a rapid course and the total course of the disease would be having a somewhat ferocious presentation and ulcerating lesions, tend to have Alpa Kandu Kledakrimi. This is again not a very rare condition. Often the patients may present with the simple, relatively symptoms, relatively painless, milder symptoms like a painless symptoms, and either it can present as an ulceration, and the whole area of the ulcers look very somewhat disturbed, like blackish, brownish color, and the surface would be irregular. Though the surface is irregular and looks like ferocious, patient would not have much aggressive pain. So a relatively painless, ferocious looking ulcer is always dangerous. You will have to be very careful. I am not saying that every ulcer of that sort is a varicose carcinoma, but when the edges are raised and then you have these irregular surfaces, chances are that it's a varicose carcinoma. Histopathologic study is mandatory. Any of those ulcers, rather the rule is if it is a painless ulcer, histopathological study is mandatory to confirm the diagnosis. Varicose carcinoma can be one of the conditions, and quite significant is in the oral area. As far as the incidence occurs, the incidence of varicose carcinoma is more common in the oral area. And though it's a locally malignant, it doesn't produce a secondary rapidly, but it's locally malignant, produces large destruction of the tissues, and hence an early surgery is always a better option than prolonging the condition as such. I would suggest surgery as the better option. And maybe at times when the surgery produces more deformity, you may have to have a reconstructive follow-up also. A plastic surgery also may be required in that condition. So that's about the varicose carcinoma, which also can occur, though not rapidly, though not frequently, it can occur quite frequently. Another of the variation of the same, that the skin thickness is hardened and the surface is rough, is the actinic keratosis. Actinic keratosis also is comparatively rare, but troublesome, many times misleading conditions. All that what you see is there will be some discoloration, roughness, patient would be feeling that roughness at the area, and more often in the exposed part like head, forehead, head, etc. And often the patient may consider this as a sun rashes. Sun rashes, which we generally consider, would be limited to only the seasons, like when a severe sunlight or you are exposed to the sunlight for long duration. But these rashes, they may remain as such. So a lesion which looks like the typical sun rashes. Sun rashes, of course, many of almost everyone has experienced on some or other day when you have exposed to sunlight for a long duration, rashes tend to occur. But that would be a temporary phenomenon. The usual word used is reversal. Now, that's a temporary phenomenon lasting for a few days or a few months, and usually April and May, many of the people would experience that. But a lesion of similar sort persisting throughout, irrespective of that exposure, and more exposed in the exposed areas like the faces, etc., could be the actinic keratosis, which is again considered to be a precancerous condition. It is difficult to manage. So important is to identify that condition. Virtually there is no curative management. I don't suggest any curative management, because none of the treatment would really help in that. But the important is, if you have identified as precancerous condition, with the chemo prophylaxis, at least the course of the disease can be reduced. At least burden of our responsibility, clinical responsibility, can be reduced. So I would not suggest any curative treatment. When a patient of that acne keratosis comes to me, usually I refer the patient to some oncologist, and because it looks very simple. Initially, the whole disease looks very simple, but when it becomes malignant, then the course will be rapid. So there will be a sudden change in the course of the disease, and then the secondary symptoms to occur rapidly. It's better to avoid that critical course. So that's how usually I manage. I don't suggest any specific management to that acne keratosis. Next part. The next is shuka upahata upamam vedanani utsannamadhyani, where the patient would have a feeling, symptom of pain, which results like a, which is felt like a worm moving over the area, and the lesion has a utsannamadhyani, the surface is raised in the middle. A typical of a bullosa, a bullous lesion. That's exactly the how the bullous lesions are described in the contemporary medicine. And among those bullous lesions, one of that is epidermolysis bullosa. That bullous epidermolysis bullosa also, where you will have a single bleb coming through, though it looks like a single lesion, critical important is to make out that differences as such. The causes could be of different variety, as well as the location also could be of different variety. Presentations also could be different. An intraepidermal would have a relatively transparent surface, the lesion would be looking somewhat transparent. Whereas a deeper, like a junctional epidermolysis, it may have a thicker, harder surface, opaque surface, as in the second picture, second shows about junctional epidermal. So there is a similarity in the pathology, but the outcome would be comparatively poor. Then you have the symptoms like dystrophender symptoms, syndromic symptoms, where there is a tendency for involvement of the renal pathologies also. And most of the times, the problem would be of the secondary infection. They look relatively simpler in the beginning, but later, all of a sudden, there will be a flare up due to secondary infection. And many times, the infecting organisms also are wide varying. Choice of the antibiotics also are difficult. Most of the times, they even be difficult, resistant to the antibiotic therapy. So, again, I would not suggest any specific line of the treatment. The patients can be managed. Many times, you will have to have some. Maybe ding dong, like at times you sit on to the antibiotic, at times you sit on to the antibiotic treatment, and so on. So, I don't suggest any specific line of the treatment. Outcome would be unpredictable. Some of the patients respond well, some of the patients do not respond well. Incidence wise, they do occur quite frequently, and they do come to antibiotic doctors many times, because patients would have experience in the treatment somewhere and then they come to us. So, somewhat critical issues. So I don't say that, I don't suggest any specific line of the treatment in case of the epidermolysis bullosa.